On this International Women's Day, we're talking to Mary Wooldridge, a long-time parliamentarian here in Victoria. She spent 13 years in the Parliament, including a stint as the Minister for Women's Affairs in the Baillieu government. Welcome, Mary. Let's look at the 13 years of your career. When you look at the start and you look at the end, how is it different for women in particular?
So broadly, I think it's different because, firstly, there's more women in the Parliament and in the business community and as leaders generally. And I think the second thing that's very different is the broader environment, where we're talking about issues of gender equality, where brave young women are standing up and talking about their experiences in the workplace. And I think over the last 10 or 15 years, we haven't had that, but it's been building and momentum to get to the point where we are now, where women's leadership and women's role is firmly in the national spotlight.
Female participation and representation in politics in Parliament is still lagging, if you like. What's it going to take to bring equality in our Parliament, in our politics?
Well, I think some parties have taken very proactive steps and others haven't. And I think it's the realisation that it's no longer acceptable not to be balanced gender-wise in terms of the representation, in terms of candidates, that the community wants to see it, that voters are going to vote for it, and the parties need to come to the party, so to speak, in relation to stepping up and making sure that that happens.
At the time when women are stepping up more and more, but politics has still got this real image problem at the moment, particularly when it comes to gender, whether you've got staffers or MPs from both sides of the deck for, state, federal, politics has an image problem. How do you encourage more women to go in when we're seeing laid bare how toxic it can be?
Well, I think there is reform in the wind, and it's very positive to see. Even Kate Jenkins' work setting standards, very important for not only nationally, but through state parliaments, I think we'll reflect on that as well. But I would always encourage women to put their hand up. It was an incredible opportunity and honour and experience. But I think you have to make the journey your own. You don't need to conform to still some of the drinking cultures that exist, some of the more blokey aspects that you may feel you're missing out on something. I think people who succeed are ones who go in with an idea of what they want to achieve and the contribution they want to make. They're themselves, and they make the journey their own rather than trying to conform to some norm.
And what does more women in Parliament, in politics, mean for our society?
Well, there's no doubt role models are incredible in terms of changing the nature of the discussions, giving hope and direction to younger women in terms of that they can see themselves in those roles as they see other women achieving them. And it's the right thing to do. It's a good outcome for the economy. It's a good outcome for business and the Parliament. But it's also the right thing to do. We're a society that does believe we value men and women equally, and that needs to be demonstrated in our Parliament.
And do women support one another enough in these environments?
Well, I found it was mixed, to be fair, but I experienced some incredible times where women did support each other, and not just within the party, but across the parties as well. We had some issues, some social issues, where a group of women from across all parties came together to work out how to achieve an outcome in relation to an issue that was very, it was about safe access zones for women around abortion clinics, and it was a cross-party group of women who mobilised to achieve what we believe was the right outcome, and that was delivered.
You've now transitioned and are heading the Workplace Gender Equality Agency. What's your plan to bring about equality and equity in Australia? It's such a big issue.
It is such a huge issue, and unfortunately at the current rate, and things are improving year on year, but the rate of change is very slow, and it's going to take, our estimates is about 25 years to have pay equity across the country. So, that's too long. So our challenge is to accelerate the rate of change. Part of that is demonstrating the benefits from an economic sense, but also appealing to the broader values and societal outcomes in terms of treating women and men equally. We have a whole range of plans in terms of how we work with business to help support them to drive the change. But I also think that the workforce changes it as well. This generation, new generation of workers have different expectations from their workplace. It's not just the job and pay, it's actually about values, it's about balance, it's about the roles they want to play in terms of caring and family responsibilities as well as work. And I think not only will it be led by business and community leaders, it'll also be driven by a workforce demanding a different environment for them to work and contribute.
A recent report by your agency put the pay gap for that medium to large private enterprises at 23%. That's staggering. Do we need to really go radical here?
Ultimately, business leaders are driven by the economics and the outcomes and delivering profitability and value for shareholders if they're publicly listed. And that's where the argument, if they can't get the workforce in a tight labour market, they're going to have to change. So I think the imperatives will come more broadly. And what we try and do is make sure they then have the tools and the guides on how to drive that shift and where that needs to go. We can't demand it, I don't believe, but I think that the broader community will demand it and that will drive the change most effectively.
One of the criticisms around International Women's Day is that it centres white middle-class women in the debate. How do you ensure that it is inclusive?
Well, it's absolutely critical that we do have a more nuanced discussion rather than just a male and female discussion. And it's not easy. From an agency perspective, we don't collect that data currently, but we certainly seek to, and we'll be working with employers about how they can capture that information in the first place so that we can then get it from them and actually understand from an evidence base what is the economic situation, what is the workplace situation, what in terms of a broad range of diversity factors. So we don't even have the information at this point. But there is a very strong chorus of voices of women and men saying we need it. So there's a big, strong pull factor. And there's some great organisations like the Diversity Council who are doing some great work, and we're collaborating with them as well. So it's early days, but it's absolutely necessary. I think there's a recognition of that, and we see a clear pathway to have that information and therefore be able to debate that from an evidence base.
So where do you think the positives are in all of this?
Well, I think there are positives because we're definitely improving on every measure in terms of gender equality in workplaces to date. The challenge is the rate of change. But I think we're seeing momentum in terms of the national debate. We're seeing momentum in terms of business leaders putting their hand up and committing to this and driving it. And I think importantly, we see it from the next generation of workers who will demand it. I'm optimistic that change is there. We've just got to remain vigilant and drive hard to make sure it's delivered.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Karen.